Hello, welcome everyone. Thank you, Justin. All right. Hello and welcome. Welcome to Influencing for Change. This is an abridged workshop of the Shifting Power Accelerator, an online cohort-based course that helps you push for meaningful change in 8 weeks. So this is a 60-minute introductory workshop on using influence to push for equitable partnerships in the global nonprofit, philanthropic, and public sectors. Thank you, everyone, for joining. And as you join us, please share in the chat your name, your location, and a favorite place that you like to visit near your home. So emojis are very welcome. I enjoy them very much. While you do that, I'll take a moment to introduce myself. I'm Maya Hasan, a Pakistani and American non-binary woman with light, medium skin tone and dark hair. I'm wearing gold tone metal rim glasses and in a black and white patterned top. In case you're wondering why I described myself there, visual descriptions are a best practice for making meetings more inclusive for visually impaired people. So I'm modeling that practice for you. And as many of you already know, I'm the facilitator of the Shifting Power Accelerator and our special workshop today on influencing for change. I'm joining you from my home in San Juan, Puerto Rico, also known by the indigenous Taino name of Borinquen. I'm very excited to be your host today and looking forward to a lot of interaction and I'm sure some rich discussion. That checks off my name and location. And now I'm going to share a place that I love to visit near me, and I'm going to keep it super simple. I recently started a daily walking habit in my neighborhood. It's been a few months now. So every day I try to take a walk in a different direction, but I usually find myself returning to the same place. I live near an art museum in San Juan that has a beautiful garden in the back that's open to the public. So it's an oasis from the sights and sounds of the city. And it's a special place that I'm very grateful for in my neighborhood. So I'm going to see if anyone else has shared in the chat. I see Levon loves visiting a Thai restaurant. That's great. The National Arboretum. Oh, I love the National Arboretum, Washington, D.C., Shenandoah. Yes, beautiful. The local supermarket in Faridabad, India. Oh, lovely. I love that. It can be busy, but also it's nice to get lost in the chaos sometimes too, isn't it? All right. I'd also like to welcome Kate Cummings, who's here with me today. Kate is the newest member of the Fearless Project, which is the hosting organization of the Shifting Power Accelerator. Kate is our advisor for strategy and programs, and I'm really excited to have her with us today. Kate will be acting as my behind-the-scenes co-facilitator and helping to share links and making sure that we don't miss any questions. So I see Deborah's hand is up. So Deborah, would you like to share a place near your home that you love to visit?
Yeah, I couldn't fit my location in the little space beside my name. I'm actually talking to you from the unceded and unsurrendered territories of the Algonquin Anishinaabe peoples. I live in a place called Vieux Hall, which is actually part of Gatineau, Quebec, Canada. And I like to walk, there's a little island, it's quite urban where I am, but I walked to a little island as I did this morning in the canal, and it's a beautiful little garden.
Thanks for sharing. Great. Thanks everyone again for joining and for sharing so freely. I think we're off to a great start. Another thing that I like to do at the beginning of workshops is to make sure that we're sharing in norms, community norms when it comes to participating in workshops. First things first, very important, and it's true for all my workshops and any social spaces that we occupy, is to be reflecting on power. This is so important to not only give space to others, but also to contribute, right? To take up space occasionally, but to be aware of the power dynamics that may exist whether related to race, gender, class, education, even language. So making sure that you're giving adequate space to others, especially people who may be from historically marginalized backgrounds. In addition to that, be relational, being present, using body language, reactions, and chat, making the space feel welcoming, not only through words, but also through texting, through reactions and the like. Another thing that I like to remind folks when attending my workshops is to, at least in the beginning, to stay muted if you can. Sometimes we have a different dynamic in every workshop in terms of the personalities that show up. Some people are very outspoken and others are quieter, to give more space to others to start with raising hands to speak like Deborah did. So thank you so much, Deborah, for modeling that for me. We have 31 people here today, not a huge group, but a good sized group. I think it would be great to lean into that. We also have a Q&A box that we can use to drop in your questions if you have them, or use the chat, and Kate will be very helpful in making sure that we find all those questions and get them answered in the time that we have today. Please turn on your videos if you can. If you cannot, completely understand that as well. If you'd like to step away for a moment, let us know. So you can use the reaction, the coffee cup to let me know if you've stepped away, or let us know in the chat. We have enabled closed captions and transcript for you. So for those of you who asked for that, that is available. You can also turn it off if you so choose. Normally in our workshops, we take 5 to 10 minute breaks every 50 minutes. Since this is a 60 minute workshop, we will not be taking a break. But as I mentioned earlier, you're welcome to step away. All workshops in the Shifting Power Accelerator are recorded. This one is recorded as well, and it will be available in the next couple of days. So you can expect that in your email inboxes in case you need to leave early. That's no problem. What else? Is there any other community norms or suggestions that you have to make this workshop as fulfilling as possible to you to make sure that this is a safe and brave space? Without further ado, here's a quick overview of today's session. First, we're going to start with how to identify power by type, the differences between authority or influence, so giving a bit of definitions and shared language. We'll move on to how and when to use power-based, rights-based, or interest-based approaches to change. Many of you may have heard of power-based or rights-based approaches, but may be less familiar with interest-based approaches. So that's something that we'll go into. And finally, the key elements of a successful change initiative. This is according to best practice from change management, the change management discipline, as well as case studies, interviews I conducted with various folks working across the sector in pushing for change. So what are those key elements? We'll talk about that and we'll share that. So that's the agenda. And the really important part of this is I want this to be as enjoyable as possible. So as mentioned earlier, please feel free to drop in your questions or reactions in the chat as they are coming up for you. Raise your hand, use body language, emojis too. This is a workshop after all. It should be hands-on. And before we jump into the workshop, I also want to share very quickly my backstory and why I started the Shifting Power Accelerator. So here are a few of the nonprofit organizations, grassroots, national and international organizations that have trusted me in my 20 plus year career. There's a photo here of me with my Bangladeshi and Rohingya colleagues while we carried out research in the refugee camps outside of Cox's Bazar, Bangladesh. And it was actually during my time working for international NGOs and supporting civil society programs in Afghanistan, Central African Republic, South Sudan, Bangladesh, and Myanmar that I kept encountering the same disturbing dynamic. Within the INGOs, there were explicit but also implicit hierarchies. Some people, the ones with the preferred nationalities or educational backgrounds, just had more power than others. In particular, light-skinned Global North staff or partners were usually empowered to make all the decisions and determine the ways of working. In contrast, darker-skinned Global South staff were usually disempowered and resigned to follow their lead. And it didn't stop there. This top-down effect rippled through our work with our partners and the communities that we were supposedly serving. Please feel free to drop a yes in the chat if this resonates with your experience. Yeah, I see the yeses coming in. All caps, yes, it does. 100%. Yeah, it's infuriating, right? So it was not only unjust in my eyes, but it also made no sense from an effectiveness standpoint. And it was wrong on so many levels. So I went on a journey of applied learning. I immersed myself in social justice, participatory approaches, equity and inclusion, and the examples of shifting power initiatives happening across our sectors. For so many, resistance to change isn't due to a lack of will, it's due to the lack of know-how. I didn't see an applied learning program out there that showed you how to do this and kept you accountable. So that's why I launched the Shifting Power Accelerator, so that emerging leaders like you and me could finally act on our values and learn the knowledge and skills to change our industry for the better. And one last note on this slide, there's a really big QR code. If you scan it with your camera or your phone, it will take you to my LinkedIn profile. So if you aren't already, please connect with me there. I would love to stay in touch. And I think Kate may also be sharing that link with you. So now today's workshop. Again, I mentioned that this is an abridged workshop from a larger module in the Shifting Power Accelerator. That larger module includes what we're covering today, as well as learning about an Oxfam Great Britain case study for influencing to create a flexible fund for small women's rights organizations. In that larger workshop, we also get familiar with and practice stakeholder mapping using that case study. So the case study is really one about interest-based approach to influencing. Mona Mehta, who is the global lead of the gender justice program at Oxfam Great Britain, launched an influencing campaign with a team of others to push for flexible funding for small women's rights organizations. She started out as a specialist in gender mainstreaming, really focused on programs, campaigning, and training. She didn't have a background in grants or compliance at all. And yet, she was able to put together this campaign, this working group, and push for this change to successfully take place, to influence her colleagues. And now she's running a multi-million-dollar flexible funding program for women's rights organizations. So that's the case study that I go into in the course. And this work workshop will be an introduction leading up to that. I'm going to hand it back to all of you who are here in attendance. I'd love to hear from you. Could you describe for me what influencing means to you in 1 to 3 words? There are various definitions, various ways of understanding what this means. Influence or influencing, what does it mean to you? What's the association that comes up? Please share a word, 2 words in the chat. I'm seeing collective action for change. What else? Changing thoughts and behaviors. I'm seeing a keyword here is change, changing perspectives. And how does that happen? What does it mean to influence? Influencing has become a more common word used in social media, right? So influencing, changing minds, opening perspectives, opening minds to different perspectives. Absolutely. So here I'd like to contrast influencing to power, or to think of influencing as a type of power, right? Traditionally, when we think of power, shifting power, we're thinking about formal ways of power. We're thinking about people or processes that give authority, in which you can give orders, you can enforce, you can be accountable. With power, traditional forms of power, there's rigidity. With influence, on the other hand, it's really much more about persuasion. So that's the key word that I want you to take away here, persuasion, the changing hearts, the changing minds, that sort of rhetoric. But how is this done? It's by asking a lot of questions. It's by being flexible, being curious, getting that buy-in and that commitment from others when you're maybe not, and especially not in a position of authority. It can happen when you are in a position of authority, but oftentimes it does not require that. The traditional way of thinking about power is more about your ability to impose your will on others, giving orders, making things happen because you occupy a certain position of authority. Maybe you're a senior leader, you're the boss of someone, right? You have direct reports and so on. That's based on authority. Influence, on the other hand, is your ability to deeply impact behaviors and beliefs. And you don't have to be in a position of authority to do this. It's based on persuasion and on convincing others. And oftentimes they can be used as tools together. So you may be in a position of authority, but still want to use influence because of how it might look, but also how it might feel to just be giving orders for sustainable change to happen. Your toolkit needs to be vast in terms of the various ways of approaches that you're using to change. Here we have not only power and say going beyond just influence, what does it also encompass? So power-based approach to change may be top-down, right? Hierarchical. It may be authoritarian or authoritative. So authoritarian has a lot of negative connotations, right? But if you are an authority and you're authoritative, you can also have an impact, which may be less negative. So there's also rights-based approaches to change, which are very prevalent, that language and that use in our sector, especially in the programming that we do when we work with historically marginalized populations and communities and so on. And it's very much tied to the social justice tradition, as well as democratic principles, right? When we look at historically marginalized groups, communities, and populations, so on, and when we look at the human rights perspectives and the human rights charter, what should be happening? Much should be taking place, and using that to create change, using the law and legal frameworks as well. And finally, we have collaborative or interest-based approaches to change, which are really rooted in conflict resolution. When you have a dispute at work and you maybe hire a mediator or an arbiter to come in and to help you negotiate a good outcome, that's really what's happening here. And so it's not only used in conflict resolution, it's also used in change management, which is a discipline that studies how changes occur within organizations, within companies, and so on. There's an entire discipline dedicated to this. There is a science as well as an art around this, but also transformative justice. So if we're looking far into the future, we're looking and hoping for liberatory futures, how is this going to happen? Is it only from a power-based perspective? Probably not, because those who want to have more power, want to earn and build that power and take it from those who have more power, are probably using a rights-based approach. But what I'm sharing here with you is that for it to be sustainable, for it to be achieved and one to be sustainable, we really need to be looking and leaning more into the interest-based approaches to change. So while we don't want to do away entirely with the others, we can use this entire toolkit that is available to us. And to help break this down a little bit more and to understand it in its various parts, I have two pyramids here. On the left-hand side, we have the power-based approach to change, whereas on the right-hand side, we have the interest-based approach to change. So in the power-based approach to change, power is the most dominant, right? Authority at the top. And that's what we're looking at, is who's making those decisions and who can make those decisions, and then who determines maybe what those rights are. And behind that, there may be interests. What's maybe hiding behind all of those things? With an interest-based approach, we're really starting from the point of interests. It is trying to interrogate and trying to understand, being curious, asking those questions. What are the real needs here? What is perhaps lacking? And so how do we build on that, then develop the rights, and then eventually move in the direction of power? So the three ways of approaching a conflict or a dispute to be resolved, and here if we're thinking and applying this to the workplace and specifically change in terms of shifting power, in terms of inviting, leaning more into locally led development, community led development, decolonizing aid, and so on, is either reconciling interests, which I'm arguing here is more sustainable in the long run, but it's probably a lot more difficult, determining who is right, determining who is more powerful. So a lot of the time when decisions are made in organizations, we follow whoever is most powerful because that's the situation we find ourselves in. To unpack these a bit more in terms of definitions, what again are interests? They encompass needs, desires, concerns, fears. What does one really care about, or what do they want? Rights, on the other hand, are accepted independent standards used to determine who is justified and deserving. So again, in an international framework or in a national framework, that could be the laws. in the framework of an organization, that's the policies, perhaps, or the procedures and that sort of thing. Power, on the other hand, the ability to coerce people to do something they would not otherwise do. And again, coercion here is a bad word, right? And we don't want to become coercing anyone. But sometimes if someone is expressing very bad behavior, is violating the rules and the rights of others, usually an authority figure may step in and say, this is unacceptable. In what situations should we use each type of approach? Let's break this down in terms of pros and cons, advantages and disadvantages of each approach. Under power, we have the ability as a pro, an advantage, the ability to assert control and impose a solution, and it goes a lot quicker. Sometimes you need to make those quick decisions and make things happen immediately. Power also trumps rights and interests at the end of the day, as much as we would prefer the rights and the interests to be more dominant. People in positions of power are able to make things happen over the case of rights and interest-based approaches. The negative, and there are many, it invites a power response. So power is then perhaps met with another kind of power, whether people power or something else. It's not always clear who has the power, because power oftentimes is derived usually from rights or interests or something else like that. Not always, but sometimes. It can provoke power showdowns, adds tension. Tough on relationships, creates a baseline for all parties. So a starting point, foundation, and protections, very importantly, protections for the most vulnerable, again, historically marginalized populations, communities, and groups. It is a check on power. But there are some disadvantages. They can become escalatory and adversarial. It's not necessarily right for everything, and we'll see why when we approach like interest-based, when we talk a little bit more about interest-based approaches to change. This is a question. Is it merely an expression of power, people power or authoritarian power? These are questions. Interpretation and bias-free relies upon agreements over which external standards apply. And in case you're wondering where this is coming from, at the bottom you'll see this is understanding of negotiation methods and theory by the Harvard Program on Negotiation. The interest-based approaches to change. Advantages. There is really a possibility of a win. It's no longer a zero-sum game in the case of a showdown, say, between those in authority and those relying on rights-based approaches. It's looking at what's the interest of everyone here and how can we reconcile that? It is the least escalatory. It invites creative solutions from the whole group, everyone pitching in, coming together. It builds trust. It is highly relational as opposed to maybe the other two. Rights-based approaches may be building relationships, strong relationships amongst the people, but in terms of the power holders, perhaps not so. It depends again. Some disadvantages, it is time consuming. If you've ever participated in, say, consensus-based decision-making, let's see, it takes a lot longer. Not always, but there is usually an upfront investment at least. It requires trust, and that is, again, that upfront investment. There is a loss of control, because what if we're not able to reach consensus? What if certain parties are still able to maintain more power than others? You're trying to negotiate effectively. A risk is bargaining away your rights, because if rights are the standard, but we're moving more towards an interest-based approach, will we potentially lose those standards in the process because we've opened up the table again to renegotiate? As we said, in the power category, it's trumped by rights and power, interest-based, and it's harder to be more authoritative that way. And there's not always agreement. So we're going to apply this now and do an activity. Here is an example that we can use. It's very simple, but probably a problem or a challenge you may have encountered in your workplace. Here we have Alejandro, who goes by he, him pronouns. In his position, right, where he's starting from, is that the air conditioning should be set at 21 degrees Celsius, which is 70 degrees Fahrenheit. Okay, that is his position, and he's sticking to it. Maria Isabel, who goes by she, her pronouns, says that the air conditioner should be set at 24 degrees Celsius or 75 degrees Fahrenheit. Why? What's behind this position? That's what their position is. That's their starting point. But what are their interests, really? Alejandro says he wants to be cooler, He doesn't want to sweat. That's very uncomfortable being in the office, such a high temperature. He feels hot, so really needs to reduce that temperature, right? And Maria Isabel, on the other hand, wants to avoid a draft. She doesn't want to be freezing. She feels really cold, okay? So now if we're taking the different approaches, again, it's very simple example, but I wonder if there'll be some heated discussions here. Heated, no pun intended. What are the different approaches to resolving this conflict? If we're to apply the power-based, the rights-based, and the interest-based approaches to change, okay? Because we are 30 participants and I want to give you all a chance to have some time to speak, we're going to go to breakout rooms, okay? And for 10 minutes, we'll bring it back and then we'll have a group discussion. Would love to hear what you thought. So here's a few questions to help you with your conversation if you need it. They're just guiding questions. What might be a power-based approach to change? What could be a rights-based approach to change? What is an interest-based approach to change? So analyzing this tension that we have in the office and how can we find a solution? Is one better than the other in this situation and why? What if the contexts were different? So you're going to make some assumptions about this context, right? With that, Kate, could you give me a thumbs up once the breakout rooms are open? Okay, great. So feel free to go to some breakout rooms and we'll see you in 10. Okay, welcome back, everyone. So how did that go? Who feels like sharing? Were there any heated debates? What was the conclusion that you came to? Feel free to raise your hand if you'd like to share, report back what was discussed, any takeaways, reflections. Neha, go ahead.
Hi, thank you, Maya, for holding this space. And we had a very low-key discussion, not a very heated debate, very cool debate. Yeah, so we discussed the interests and there were three points of views, different points of views. One was that going completely mathematical on it and just having the temperature come to a median, which is 22.5 degrees. But we also felt as a group, while it is a mathematical and a completely logical solution, maybe it's not, it avoids the interests of both. So it's not a win solution, it's a lose solution. Currently, the situation is win-lose in either case. So here we have two losers instead of two winners or one winner. So that was one point of view. Another point of view was contextualizing the whole thing and talking about what is the temperature outside, what is the climate like, what is the weather like. So we can't really arrive at a solution till we know what is that like. So how do you decide who is right? So how do you decide the rights-based approach? Then we also discussed there are some studies that are done that talk about how people who are born females, they have a higher temperature, thermal body temperature. So they need the AC temperatures, lower temperatures or something of that sort, which one gender needing the temperature to be cooler and one gender needing the temperature to be hotter in comparison to each other, not in absolute terms. Yeah, so maybe we need to contextualize this not just on the basis of climate and weather, but also on the gender needs. And another thing that we just discussed was maybe to just come to a kind of conciliatory approach. Maybe we can have, it turn wise. So one type of temperature on one day and one type of temperature on one day, or one type of temperature on one week and another week, another type of temperature. So yeah, we discussed all of these. Thank you.
Wonderful. Yeah, I love those creative solutions. I saw that there were two other people that had hands up, but now I see that those hands have disappeared. Amanda, go ahead.
Yeah, sorry, I got interrupted by kids, but I'm back. Yeah, I agree with what the last group was chatting about. And we talked a little bit about context. And in this case, where we're talking about two people, an interest-based approach seemed like it would be the best approach because there's lots that these two people could come together and compromise on in terms of where they're sitting, close to the AC or not. and really understanding each other's interests and ideas for how to resolve this would help in the long run, as opposed to the other two approaches, which might escalate things or cause resentments or more power imbalances going forward. But then my partner in the group raised, like, what if the context was different? And what if it was a climate emergency, or what if there's electricity shortages or whatever? And so then we talked about, like, in those cases, and when we're talking about at a population level, that kind of interest-based approach becomes a lot more challenging. And so in cases like that, when we're talking about climate crisis, or I raised an example of in South Africa, the load shedding that they have to do, when you're talking at that population level, that's where that power approach, while maybe not as popular and maybe people grumble about it, is sometimes necessary for kind of the larger good of the population, or even the rights-based approach when we're talking about climate. So yeah, just adding those layers in and over to others.
Yeah, thanks so much, Amanda. Hamish, really quickly, go ahead.
I have an interesting discussion about the concept of accountability, and there is a sense where power-based approaches are often, maybe are so prevalent because they're one of the most common ways to assure accountability. Someone has to pay for their electricity bill, for example, and whether that is a relevant factor in whether that person has power. Thinking about accountability and power-based approaches, thanks.
I love the directions that this conversation went. Kamar, if you have, I don't know, 30 seconds, you want to share very quickly because we're running out of time.
Thank you. I just wanted to highlight two other aspects. One is the culture, how the power structures have been defined within that culture. And secondly, the culture of accountability. If there is any accountability system is in place, so it will definitely affect the overall power structures as well. So the culture and then the accountability system or structures availability in place. These are two other aspects I wanted to highlight. Thank you.
Yes, very important notes. I intentionally didn't give you much in terms of the context so that you could extrapolate and apply to different contexts. So I'm glad that the discussion was very fruitful, very creative, lots more to consider in different contexts. So moving on and transitioning to the key elements for successful change initiatives. So now that we've talked a little bit about approaches to change in terms of the how, these are key components or characteristics based on the evidence, actually, based on studies that have been done in terms of when you're launching a change initiative, trying to push or advocate for a type of change within your organization. What are the transformations that tend to stick? What are the ones that are successful? And what are those characteristics? What do you think? What are some key elements that are really important? Please feel free to drop those in the chat. We would be great to hear from you, your educated guesses, or maybe from your personal experience. What is some aspects, some elements that are really important in the case of change initiatives happening within your organizations? So I'm seeing from Levon, participation from multiple levels in crafting the solutions. Yes, this helps with buy-in. Yes, and also important from an interest-based perspective, consultative process. Yes, we talked about influencing and how that's really important to get buy-in. Education for all employees. Yeah, actually, that is a key criterion. We'll learn more about that in a second. Culture and values, absolutely, really critical. Having shared values, having a shared purpose, and so on. Okay, I see lots more coming into the chat. Thanks for that. Let's see if they line up with what we have here. McKinsey is a global, very large management consulting firm, but they work with a lot of international companies, a lot of international organizations. So this was specifically a global survey of those about what successful transformations share. That is a report that I will actually share with you via email, the key resource that you can check out. What did it report based on this survey of hundreds of CEOs and senior leaders? One is that the successful change initiatives must have a clear structure that is built collaboratively. So the collaborative part of it is really important. A structure, and I would extend that to be a goal, a purpose, a mission, all of those important, that framework. Having strong leadership support, as well as frontline staff ownership. So someone said from all levels, from multiple levels, and that it is employee driven, it is employee owned. So while you might have a senior leader who's a sponsor, you definitely want to have a staff working group or a group of team members, colleagues who are pushing it forward. increasing leadership capacity and staff skills through training. Someone mentioned education as being really important, because as part of this, you're transforming as an organization. You're going to have to learn new skills. You're going to have more knowledge, more competence, more confidence in certain areas to be able to act differently, to perform differently. So that's really important to actually encourage people to follow along as well. Changing mindsets and culture. Someone mentioned culture and values. This is really important, being more open-minded, embracing a growth mindset rather than being resistant to change, being more open to risk-taking, experimentation, and so on. And finally, celebrating progressive achievements. It's not enough to start a change initiative and then 6 months, a year later, 18 months later, then you report on what change occurred. You need to be continuously communicating throughout that process. You need to be celebrating everyone's achievements on the teams, marking those milestones, communicating internally, externally, and so on. So this is also a quick summary of what we just discussed, of those key elements and what that might look like. I think the keep the clear structure collaboratively, I highly recommend is putting together a strong concept note. You do this for your donors when you're trying to develop new programs. Do you do this internally when you're trying to develop a new initiative or a new way of doing things? This is actually a really clear and strong way to start on that path. And this is what others have done in terms of case studies in our sector to start to push for change internally. So I hope that was helpful. We're 5 minutes till the end. So I wanted to share this Miro stakeholder mapping and influencing tool for you. It's not enough to have these key elements or to understand your approach to change. You also need to understand who your audience is, who are all the individuals that you need to influence, who you need to involve, who do you need to get buy-in from, and so on. And so I'm going to follow up via email to everyone who registered for the workshop with this Miro template so that you can practice stakeholder mapping. Many of you have learned this in terms of programming for your organizations. You can do the same sort of activity internally. Would anyone like to share a key takeaway from today's workshop? Anything that maybe an aha moment, something you didn't consider before? Feel free to either drop it in the chat or raise your hand. And while we're waiting for folks to have a think about that, some questions for you to leave this workshop with is, what is one way that you can start using these frameworks at work? I mentioned shifting power is an area that I'm really focused on and I help folks with, but maybe there's a different topic, a different way in which you can apply these at your work. How will you keep learning and keep yourself accountable? So part of this, as we mentioned, education is really important, the continuous learning, having that open and growth mindset. I see Larissa here to my question, maybe an aha moment. Authoritative is not always bad and might be needed, for example, to protect rights. Yeah, absolutely. And that's something that I've been thinking about a lot too. It's tricky, but yeah, that is definitely one key learning. As I mentioned earlier, and as we conclude, this 1 hour workshop was just a taste of a similar 2.5 hour workshop during week 3 of the Shifting Power Accelerator. So it's absolutely up to you. But if you enjoyed this work and you're interested in joining the upcoming cohort, it starts 10 days from now on Tuesday, July 2nd. What does it include? It's 35 hours of content over 8 weeks, 1 2.5 hour live workshop per week, 1 office hour with me or question and answer session with special guest experts. Actually, we have lined up Hibak Kalfan, who's executive director at Near Network. We have Demrees Khan, who is a scholar and practitioner in the Shift of Power movement. And we also have Vanessa Stevens from the Global Fund for Children, who will be joining us for those expert Q&A sessions. We have self-paced weekly assignments to be completed with a community accountability partner that you choose. And by the end of the course, you'll have developed a concept note very much in line with this Influencing for Change workshop for a Shifting Power initiative that you can start implementing at work. And I know that change doesn't happen overnight. So we have a built-in community of practice, including individual coaching, quarterly Zoom support calls, a WhatsApp group and an email listserv so that I can continue supporting you and that you can continue benefiting from the supportive peers. So again, if you're interested, no pressure, feel free to mark your calendars for these dates. Enrollment ends in 10 days. Monday, July 1st workshop is going to start the next day on Tuesday, July 2nd. And if you are ready to enroll, really amazing. And I do have a promo code for you, which is workshop25, that I hope will sweeten the deal. It's 25% off the course. And if you're leaning towards joining, but something is holding you back, like the cost, please feel free to reach out to me and let me know. I'd be happy to jump on a call with you, and together we can figure out, you know, if it's a good fit. And even if the course is not a good fit for whatever reason, that's completely fine. I would love to stay in touch with you. And if you're willing, I would love to hear your feedback about this workshop. It's really important to me that we're addressing the pain points when it comes to shifting power in our industry. So if you have a suggestion of future workshops or a way to make it better, I would love to hear it. Finally, I mentioned it before, but I'll mention it again because I can't say it enough. If you're passionate about shifting power, building equitable partnerships, and empowering local and community leaders, I want to be around you. This movement is only as strong as the ties that we build. So if we're not already connected on LinkedIn, where I tend to hang out most on social media, please send me a message. Let's get connected. I want to support you as well in whatever way that I can. So please feel free to reach out. Thanks again for joining the workshop. I enjoyed myself and all of your rich insights. So have a wonderful day, afternoon, or evening, wherever you're joining us from. Take care.